And so, apologies. But either which way, I think we're just done with the back of the head and the sides of the head. So now what you can see is I've got this flat little shape, really utilizing that concave technique to keep everything really lean through the internal aspect of the haircut, but keeping a little bit of softness through the sides, which we'll play with. And then as the shape begins to transition around the back of the head, you can see with changing the overall technique is it's began to build out a bit of roundness. This is dropping from the top, so we'll just chip it in. Building up roundness through the occipital region, but then keeping a little bit of elongation through that bottom nape. And again, on the mannequin heads, I really like to do that just because when these things become too short in the back, there's really no in between. It's either gonna be like short and you gotta begin really grooming it down, almost scissor over combing it, making it really tight to look tidy, or you know, maintaining a little bit of softness. It's just, it is what it is. It's what you're working on, isn't it? But again, like as we teach, it's never really to teach a haircut. These are always here to teach kind of ideas followed by strong foundations to challenge yourself and your own creativity behind the chair, because that's what's going to make you the strongest hairdressers you possibly can, is understanding strong technique and foundations, taking those principles and then transitioning them and transforming them to suit the individual that you're working on. Suitability, that should always be, you know, leading you within your work behind the chair. Now we're going to move into the top.
Elizabeth Tamburini says, I like use a razor for that.
You like to use a razor for it? Elizabeth. Elizabeth says she likes to use it. Elizabeth, I love to use a razor as well. I just try to keep myself back and forth between scissors, razor when I do these lives to keep, I think, everything a little bit more interesting for me. But absolutely, it's like whatever tool that suits your fancy or suits the individual to create the aesthetic, that is what you use and what you do. So now as we come into the top, you can quickly see how this haircut could take on so many different personas, you know, within, if we keep it a little bit longer and softer through the top, it can definitely take on a rendition and a feeling of a few of our previous trend haircuts where we played with these disconnected elements. I mean, if I wanted to maintain enough length in here to kind of like slick it back, I would just begin to assess and look at the bend in the hair and saying, okay, I need at least like 4 or 5 inches up off of this front hairline to get enough weight so I can transition and move back. But I think today I'm going to take it quite short and a little bit more like overall pixie-esque. So I'm going to take this hair, I'm going to groom it back.
Leslie Spencer says hi from Toronto.
Leslie Spencer from Toronto. Do I know that name? Leslie Spencer. Well, hi, Leslie. I know that name. I'm just giving you a bad time. Hope you're all well and you're staying warm in Toronto. And I understand you're coming to California and the front end of the year, and I look forward to seeing you, meeting you, hanging. Either way, back to it. So vertical section right down the center of the nape, or center of the nape, center of the interior of the head. And I'll check for a bit of balance. I might be a little heavy on that left side. Cool.
Bethlehem PA is watching.
Bethlehem, hello. Hi. Cheers from to you all for tuning in.
Cincinnati, Ohio. We got someone from England.
England, good afternoon to my friends in the UK. So here we are, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna come right back here up off the crown, and I'm going to reference my length sitting in at that crown from that last bit of graduation. Now I'm gonna begin to pull this straight out from the shape of the head, from that crown. And I'll begin what we'll call working a bit of a round layer now, working from the tips of the fingers down right into that length guide. I'm going to change over a scissor. I'm going to go into something slightly smaller as I work through these kind of more delicate sections on the top. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to just very effortlessly follow now the shape of the head around. Here's my length guide. And I'm gonna work this through that second knuckle, And then as I come off into the frontal bone, I'm going to take this and pull it up off the round of the head. So some people may call this a round layer, uniform layer. You know, there's 100 different names for everything. It's just figure out what works for you and work through it. So now I've got this soft little kind of mohawk round layer through it.
Denise says hi from Michigan.
Michigan. So now what I'm going to do is, you remember that shape in that crown was a bit more, call it like a rounded V. So I'm going to work pivotally out, begin rounding out the shape through the top. So now everything is stemmed from that center back. And again, I'm going to be working off the round of the head. So I took that first section and I pushed it right into the second section. That's assuring me that I'm not taking the new section I'm working on and over directing it back. So everything should be pulled respectfully out from the base. So here, and then following the natural curvature aspect of the head, removing that out, bring that down, and coming right back in, pivot, and there'll be a little bit of disconnection which will chip off at the end between the sides and the top. I'm going to take section number one, groom it away. Now I'm taking two. Notice how I just picked up two, right back with the tight teeth of the cutting comb, pushing it right back into three, finding the clarity of my line. And can you see enough between the black and the black, or should I remove this top?
Because
I can simply take off the
jumper. It's working.
It's working, okay. Oh yeah, it's okay. And working this through, following the natural curvature aspect of the head.
Hello from Quebec.
Quebec, hello. People viewing in from all around the world. That's the coolest thing about the HB community. We got people tuning in respectfully from wherever they're situated on this globe. And then we're gonna take this bit here, and we're gonna run out of hair. So taking the previous section, pushing it right into the new, following that natural curve. One more. See a little bit down here that needs to be addressed. A little fringe is getting unruly at me. You can play with these mannequins enough, and through my time I definitely have. You kind of figure out what lengths are ideal for them and what lengths you want to stay away from. Just so you don't work yourself into a corner. And I say that, but I shouldn't say that too quickly, because who knows? There we go. Cool. So I've got a little bit of disconnection between the sides and the top. Very little, but that'll be checked off once it's dry. I'm just getting that rough shape in. Now we're gonna come back in and do the exact same thing. So pivoting off and Matthew, for yourself, would it be best if I rotate that head 180 degrees, or do you want to keep her right there and I just continually work in
that? You could keep her right there because we could see the over direction.
So now I'm taking, still pulling into myself. Ideally, I would preferably stand on the other side of the head, but
sure.
I'm here. So taking that first section, pulling it into the new section. Follow that natural roundness. You know, and I've been teaching for 20 some odd years, you know, on all different levels, from academies to brands and different academies, or lower level academy to high level academy to brands and so forth, you know, going in salons. And I find that, you know, most hairdressers are very just challenged with the basic simple concepts of like how to develop strong shape and technique. And, you know, I think we as hairdressers and teachers sometimes can become overindulgent on what we're offering out and trying to teach somebody for the sake of creativity or whatever it might be, that I think we just need to slow our roll at times, to slow the pace. And it's really about just giving them small, kind of like digestible information that they can then take in, go back in, empower themselves, practice. Because really, as we understand, call it the foundations or the principles of cutting hair, it's really simple, isn't it? If you really understand it. And I always have said, like, I feel like I could teach it to me. I used to say my son, but now I'll say my daughter, my 11-year-old little daughter, in a matter of an hour. You know, you got these three shapes, you got these techniques, you got some dynamics, you got this body position, da 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 da. And then obviously you got, you know, density, texture of hair, and all that awareness, growth patterns. But really where the complexity, I think, of cutting hair comes in is taking those ideas and those principles and then shaping them to suit the individuals in whom are coming in and sitting in your chair. So you're giving them, we'll call it bespoke haircuts, you know, truly haircuts that are suited for that individual and not, we'll call, like, cookie cutter haircuts, where it's like, I know five haircuts and everybody gets, you know, one of the five. And really, for yourself as an artist, craftsperson, hairdresser, however you want to refer to yourself, I mean, I think that's the quickest way to get burnt out and possibly bored within your career path. So it's just about understanding those principles. I suppose, like, so many people are so strong in color nowadays that it'd be like doing color and only having maybe one or two formulas, you know what I mean? Because you didn't understand the primary principles of color, being like, you know, primary colors, tertiary colors, or secondary colors, tertiary colors, quaternary colors, all that, you know? And understanding how those kind of foundational principles really unlock your inner creator to create, you know, unique shades or, you know, bespoke formulations for the individuals that you're working on. Because we know, on top of all of that, is a colorist. The other huge factor, again, is it's the individuals that you're working on. It's the density of the hair, it's the texture of their hair, it's their chemical history. So, you know, it's really about understanding these principles. And I think that's, you know, at R&Co EDU, in the last couple of years, something that we've really began to kind of like surround ourselves with are these kind of core foundational principles. So then you as the hairdresser can take them and manipulate them and, you know, begin to create your own looks, opposed to creating what we'll call inspirational kind of classes, where I'm going to teach you a haircut and I'm not going to teach you how to change it or morph it by any means. So I'm going to wipe that down a little bit. And I'm going to move off into a little bit of a blow dry. And I need some weight and memory to the hair. So I'm gonna come in with our Surreal Styling Serum by Blue. And it's got a very kind of light jelly consistency in the hand. So that's in the hand. And I'm gonna take that, emulsify it, kind of work it through, and then I'm going to begin to kind of, with the fingers, working it through the hair that has not been already dressed, which is really that right side and the top. The left side, like I say, has already been somewhat blown dry down. Push this. Matthew, you might throw me that towel back behind you.
Yeah.
Get the product off the hands. And then we're going to come in with the tight teeth of a cutting comb today. And our blow dryer with a nozzle. I'll keep it right here. This off. Step out, grabbing my blow dryer, the nozzle. And the tight teeth of a cutting comb. And the reason I'm going to use the tight teeth of the cutting comb is obviously the teeth are a lot more color condensed opposed to a Denman style brush or a vest brush. So it's going to help us kind of keep this hair a bit more compact. And I really want this to be head-hugging, because I know if I can get it head-hugging, I can easily make it expansive after the fact. If I blow-dry this hair, I know on these mannequins, too blown out and upward, it just begins to look a little too full. So trying to keep the shape to be modern. So high heat, high fan speed. Before I get into it, It should go quite quickly. So, taking the tight teeth of the cutting comb, just really molding this hair down, utilizing the heat of the blow dryer with that nozzle to really press this hair. And on that top, I want it to sit really kind of lean. And as I get down into the sides, I'll begin just dressing that quite flat. I'm going to take that fringe area and begin to lightly sweep it to that right side. Just so it moves with some softness. Nice thing about a manicure is that you keep that blow dryer focused in one area for a longer period of time than you can a human, because obviously I'm not going to burn the manicure. But try to practice good habits of keeping it always moving. Back of the hand. Almost dry, and then it's like watching paint dry. Come back in, just kind of utilize this comb to wrap.
Chris Ray says, I love how you're using a cutting comb for a blow dry.
Chris Ray.
I love this technique. To...
What up, Chris? How you doing, my friend? Yeah. Myself as well. Always enjoy utilizing like that tight teeth of the cutting comb when I'm looking for like really kind of compact shapes, you know. Obviously it's going to stretch the hair a bit more than a dim end brush, because again of the teeth of the comb, and then utilizing the spine of that comb almost like compressing it down, sealing down that beautiful layer.
Tony Sadiq says, hey Adam, thank you for sharing.
Tony, how you doing, my friend? My these are all the stuff. My network, my friends. Point is we've established a really rough, wet shape. And that shape is something that was concave on the sides, cut shorter through the inside, longer out through the external length, so we have a little bit of softness to play with. As we begin to move around the back of the head, our finger angle shifted, where we played with a little bit of round graduation and came into the bottom nape, and then kicked our finger angle out to the opposite, making it a bit more concave again to collapse it down and around, and then we came through the top and just began to work pivotally from the back crown of the head, working around little layered shape. And I'm going to cut into this, but until I get into that area, just to help out with getting this to move a little bit softer off to that right side, pinner. And I'm going to show you just some finishing techniques through it. Keeping an eye on the time. So I'm going to come right back into the top. And for the finishing, I'm going to jump back into a wider tooth cutting comb. Reason being is it's going to pull up the hair a little bit more loosely, opposed to the comb that I have been using, where the wide teeth are still a little bit more further apart, but you can definitely see that I'm gaining at least another, like, call it 16th of an inch here. So I'm going to come in and I'm going to work just now horizontally through the top, and I'm going to just begin to point cut, really kind of call it intentionally through the top. And those intentions are, you know, I'm looking for a bit more of a shape that's going to have a broken texture, so I'm a little bit more heavier handed within it. So closing that scissor always on the way out. Reason being, I feel like, is it creates a softer edge. So there's a reason as to why, not just to do it. Second reason being is if I do happen to catch my fingers, that cut's not nearly as bad because it's a, call it a softer cut, opposed to going in and closing down the scissor on my finger. So not breaking or destroying the shape. The shape's still there, but now just beginning to soften it and refine it. Come back into that back crown, bring that up. Now the crown of the hair on these mannequins is where obviously so much of that hair has been punched in. So I'm a little bit heavier handed when I get into that back area here, just to begin to obviously get a little bit more action out of it. So now as I come into the top, or I'm sorry, the sides, I'm going to spin the head to the side, and then I'm going to work up and over the shape of the head. And this is where I can begin to see if I had any disconnection between the sides and the top. This is where I can quickly begin to melt it through, very little. But you can see now the overall shape, that roundness, kind of this falling, the natural round of the head. Release that down. And just looking for a really, when I'm point cutting, looking for, call it a contrast of coloration through the hair, where it's darker, it's definitely a little bit heavier, where it's a little bit leaner, lighter, and that's where I'm gonna obviously be a little bit lighter within it. So I'm just trying to balance that out. Break that up. And I'll play with this just a little bit. I'm just gonna pick this up. There we go. Just begin to tap into this. Cool. And then we know when we're doing this that the more that we angle the scissor, the more, like, obviously kind of weight you're gonna pull out. Some people may call that notching or chunking. You know, it's all forms of point cutting as we're utilizing the points of the scissor. So now as I come back into the round of the back, working a little bit more diagonally so I respect the shape, the way that it was originally created.
Tony Sadiq says, great control.
Cheers, Tony. Thank you. So, working through, and then I know that the lower the fingers drop down into this skull, the deeper I'm going to get down there with my point cutting. So, you know, you have so much variation at this point on what you want to do within creating, like, we'll call it this internal texture. This, and this is part, like, when I teach a class, I really begin to allow the students to go kind of like wild, because it's amazing to watch them, like, take their own ideas and inspirations and begin to, like, you know, call it transform the shapes of the haircut. Because if I were to teach you all to pick up the hair the same way, point cut into it, we're all going to have a different, we'll call it aggression to it. The way the angle of the scissor is, to the way that we're, how deep we're going, how many times you're point cutting into one section opposed to the next. So that's really where haircuts begin to take on their kind of their persona, their personality, their quirkiness, you know? So,
our friend Renee says, looking good.
Renee, thank you, Renee. So coming back up and around.
Yeah. And
breaking up some of that weight from their round graduation. So slipping that, and then, you know, every time after I cut, I begin just to kind of come back through, pick it up, and to see the overall texture that I've created throughout the hair. And is it giving that internal support? Now, I used, again, a little bit of Surreal Styling Serum through the hair, which is going to give the hair some memory, some shine, a little bit of weight, you know? But the idea with me with, like, texturizing hair and cutting into it is I want to make sure that I've got enough internal texture through the haircut that it has the ability to support itself without the abundance of additional product. The product is really like the icing on the cake, you know what I mean? It should be there just to draw out more shine or to possibly mattify the hair and take the shine away, depending on what you're looking to create, or to give it some, you know, additional memory support. But you should not be utilizing your product to create the structure, if you will, within the overall finish. That should really be developed within your technique as well as your finishing. Put that up. And we're going to spin back up and over and just chase off a little bit of this weight in the bottom. So this is now, I want to keep these lengths, but I want to create a bit more diffusion through them. So you can see I'm not really changing the shape. But I'm definitely beginning to give it some airiness. So it's going to sit a little bit more gingerly, if you will, into the back of the head. A little bit deeper through here because I like it when it gets some shallowness to it. So I'm actually intentionally going in and creating some deeper notches, call it negative space. So as that does begin to fall, it takes on a lot more separation. It's a little bit more whimsical. Now remember, on a mannequin head, you really only have two options. It's going to be soft, or you want to take it short, because these things, there's really no in between. A little heavy here, so pick that up. There's no mirror, so I'm only referencing this aerial view. Oh, look at, there is a mirror over there. Cool. And then, let's see, I've done this side. I've done this side, I've done the back. I think I've got to work this side down a little bit. Yeah, it's quite heavy. I think I knit myself. That's just a constant for Hairbrain Lives. It's always the nip of the finger. I think if she should be good to go. I just wipe her down and keep moving. Well, we're just about through. Because you could sit here and continually play all day. And this is really, again, the personalization of the haircut. So there we go. Let's see where we're at. I gotta pull that fringe out and take a look at it. Haven't really done anything with the fringe. Just bring her up. I'm going to get the fringe more to my eye level. Yeah, that's better. Sorry. So for the fringe, I'm going to jump into the razor. And when I grab the razor, I'm going to quickly change the blade on it. And I'll be right back there. Go. There we go. Coolio. Alright, so fringe. So the fringe is where you get to really obviously create something that's going to suit the individual. And fringes should always be cut that way. There's not one way, not two ways, not three ways, not 100 ways to cut the fringe. So it's all about suitability and adaptability. And again, on these mannequins, I know that the shorter I go, the harder it's gonna sit. So if I wanna maintain a bit of softness, I'm going to begin just to try to break some of this up. So looking at some of that texture that's been created in the back, seeing where I might want to push this fringe. You can always use the razor. Just begin to piece out little bits. Cool. So now as I come in here, I'm going to just kind of go for the fringe. I'm going to have it be gently unstructured. So what that means, it's just going to have some brokenness to it. So I'm going to come back in, really utilizing the flat of the razor, skimming off a lot of that additional weight, having it pop up a little bit, and then I'm going to have it decrease in length as it drops to that left side, my left or right, pulling the weight up off of it, laying down, and then always thinking, like, when I get a little bit of that product in there and how it's going to take this hair and gather it together, how that's going to begin to look. I like the length here, but I'm just going to take some of that space out. And then same thing here, I like some of the length in the corner, but I just want to take some of the space out. So I'm just really going in and carving out little, call it dimensions and or holes. Maybe this bit needs to be chopped a little bit. And then what we're going to do is I'm going to chase off a little bit of weight back behind, which we will never point cut into. Take this a little bit more aggressive because it's a mannequin and you can do these things. So real quick, juxtaposition of contrast scissor, razor, it's very freehanded at this point. Creating something really kind of unique to Ziki here. And I love utilizing multiple tools just for contrast of texture. So still having it drop down, working something short to long. Razors in one hand, scissors in the other, so I can quickly draw down on whatever tool I'd like to use. A little bit of channeling from the top just to sit that in. Just beginning to take on an alternate being. Come back in with a little bit of a product. I'll begin just to push her around and take a look at how everything's come together. Cool. So I'm going to set my tools down for just a moment. Before I put the product in the hair, I am going to blow the hair out, get rid of any little short hairs that are sitting in it. Drop that. Okay. So, bring her down and lift her up. So, options of styling product. Got a little pomade called Elastic that I'm going to use. And Elastic is a little bit of a, call it kind of like a fibrous pomade. It's got a bit of fiber to it. And it's really kind of light and creamy. It's not a heavy holding pomade. It's nothing that's gonna make the hair really mattified, if you will. So just a bit. And I can always apply more. So I'm gonna come back in first off with that in my hands. And I begin just kind of working all of the ends of the hair. Just brushing the hair up. Getting that pomade through. Again, you saw the very little amount of pomade that I did put through the hair. And you can see, obviously, that the haircut's already beginning to kind of move and stand on end. And that is definitely due to the internal texture, but as well, we call it the support from that internal texture, and then the last bit of memory is going to come from the pomade. So that first bit of pomade gets worked through the outer shell, just lifting the hair. I'll come back in with just a little bit more, and I'm going to pull that camera back into the mold. So I'm going to step right in front. So the secondary bit of pomade, back in the hand, goes right through the hair. And now I always like to get an eyeline perspective. So now just in front of the model, client out of the chair, and begin just kind of working the secondary component of product through the hair. I like to have a comb in the hand always. And I can take the hair and begin to clump it. A little bit of Featherlite hairspray. So these are like the tools, right? Hairspray, comb, a little bit of a scissor. So if I see anything that's sticking out that I don't like, I can quickly just kind of tap it in. A little Featherlite, just when I begin to find my pieces that I enjoy. Featherlite hairspray is a very light, workable hairspray. And that's just gonna give me a bit more shine. Everything really within the blue line right now is comprised of giving great shine to the hair. All the products I've kind of chosen to use today. And there we go. That's it. And let's see. Cool. So
looks like Joan Jett.
Say again?
She looks like Joan Jett.
Little Joan Jetty.
Yeah.
Cool. So call it a short kind of rendition of like a little pixie-esque shape, something that's got some obviously kind of really soft texture moving through it. And just to quickly break down again how we went about the haircut, it was very simple. We subdivided the interior from the exterior right on the top round of the parietal ridge, coming down into a V. We worked a short little concave shape out, shorter on the inside, longer to the corners, really from that parietal region down to the bottom hairline edges. As we began to shape, move around the shape of the head, we then changed our finger angle, our tips are out, knuckles in, working a bit more round graduation, and we came down into the bottom hairline, kicked that out just to keep a little bit more softness through it. We did the same thing on the opposing side. We came into the top, we worked a round layered shape, pivoting outward everything from that crown region, cut a very kind of uniform shape. We blow dried everything with a little bit of surreal styling serum, making the haircut really kind of shape or really compact. And then we began just coming back through and breaking it up with the points of the scissor, a little channel cutting, and then really just kind of put a little fringe in there that suited Ziggy, our model here, her hair texture. And again, like these are just kind of ideas and principles. It's not like one set haircut. They're just kind of ideas. But it's really about understanding how you can utilize your different shapes and your techniques and your dynamics to really morph and create a bespoke look again for the individual that you're working on. Because that's what it's really about. It's about suitability and creating really one-off looks for the individuals that are in your chair. And that's what we're about at R&Co EDU. Be sure to follow along on our Instagram page, R&Co EDU. Our main page, R&Co and R&Co Blue. And then we've got our Facebook page, R&Co, and the website. And be sure to check us out as we're out on the road doing these excursions, which are business-focused classes, kicking off in March of next year. We're going to do a lot of academy work in our studios in Miami, as well as Sacramento here in California, as well as our road shows, which will be back out in, I think, five cities. And all of that will be launched in the next week and a half, I believe, within our educational calendar, which you'll find on the website as well as our Instagram page. So thank you again, and it's been a wonderful year here at RMCO, and I'm really looking forward to next year and seeing you guys all out on the road. I'm wishing you all a very safe and happy holiday, season's greetings from my family to yours, and cheers, peace and love.